so many friends and family here to support everyone, and the other half of you thought that this weekend was Orcus's. But thank you for coming in. My name is Charlie Kennedy. I'll be doing some stand-up for you tonight. A little bit about me. This is my first time doing stand-up comedy, so I'm a little nervous, as should you be. Another thing about me is I'm in the theater program here at North. I love theater. I love acting. If I were to pick a job to be, I'd either be an actor or a stand-up comedian. And what that means for me is either I'll make a lot of money and be successful, or I'll be a one-hit wonder in a medicine commercial. If you've ever seen a medicine commercial, you know that they're all very similar. And it always starts with an old lady, and she's usually like, I like outside activities and spending time with my family, but sometimes headaches get in the way. And the screen will turn gray and there will be somber music, and it's just her standing there, looking out a window at her family. And it's just so sad, but then it cuts and she's like, but thanks to Claritin, I don't need to worry about headaches getting in the way of my outside activities. And then she's jogging with her friends and I'm like, hold up. First of all, old ladies do not jog in herds. Second of all, she should be more concerned with her hip surgery she had a week ago than her headache. I think I have the right mannerism and characteristics to be in a medicine commercial. I don't know if you could tell by my overall manner, but I am Irish. And this is great when I'm talking to friends and they're talking about their cultures and their ethnicities and different traditions and history. And I hear that, and my 74% Irish kicks in. And I go, well, I will have you know that Irish history is both boring and very brief. And this is exactly how it happened. Oh, top of the morning to you, Kenny. How are you doing? Oh, I'm not too good, Doug. Well, what are you talking about? Well, all the potatoes are dead. Blimey! That's one of our three main food groups. What are we going to be eating now? Well, I don't know. Well, I guess tell everyone to pack their bags. We can leave Ireland and go to, I don't know, America. And so they all left. They all Irish goodbye their very own country. Irish goodbyes are great because if you're at a party or a gathering and you're not feeling the vibe, you're not grooving with everyone, you can just leave and don't tell anyone you're leaving. What I like to do is I like to leave and come back 20 minutes later, and it's really great to watch people's reactions because they didn't know I was there in the first place. What I personally like to do is I will Irish hello, which is the opposite of an Irish goodbye. So I'll show up to places without people knowing. This works for birthday parties, job interviews, business meetings, random houses with the front door unlocked. They all work perfectly, and it's great because it's a lot of fun. And however, there are a lot of restraining orders. It's a consequence, but we don't pay attention to that. Let's talk about Christmas. I know it's the middle of February, but I think Christmas traditions are very strange. I like to think that it was one group of friends that were all together, and they all kind of decided with each other. So it was one friend, and he was like, they were all eating, and he went, you know what I'm going to do this year? I'm going to take oversized socks, nail them above my chimney, and then put $20 bills in them for my children. And all his friends were listening, and they were like, oh, that's a good idea. And they all moved over to talk about that, but his one friend is over here at the other end of the table, and he's upset because his friend one-ups him in everything. And he goes, well, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to cut down a full-grown tree, put it in my living room, and decorate it with balls of glass and tiny lights. And all the friends over here, they heard that. They went, I like that idea better. So they all moved over and they were conversing. And Nancy in the back of the room, she was back here just stomping her foot like, no, you always get the best stuff. I'm gonna decorate my house in lights. And everyone just turned to her and went, Nancy. Your ideas, they're just not good enough, you know? Try again next year. And that's how it works. Christmas is a great time for friends and family. It's a great time for love and happiness. But Christmas morning is also the time of terror in the Kennedy household, because lovely Mrs. Kennedy becomes the drill sergeant of the house. I'll wake up and go down for breakfast, and she'll be in the kitchen going, "I saw a hair on the bathroom counter next to the sink. You were supposed to clean the bathroom last night. Why is there a hair on the counter?" And it's very scary, because she'll do that all day. Now, then again, she has a reason. She has a very good reason. But it's funny, because when we go to the grocery store for groceries, we'll be there, and instead of yelling at me, she'll do the mom whisper. And this is very scary, because I'll be looking at the fruit roll-ups, and she'll come over and be like, "John, we do not have time for the fruit roll-ups. We have guests coming over in 3 hours, and we need to get the ham. We have to leave the store." And then my uncle DJ comes, and I don't know what the reason is to why he's overly loud. I think it's because he's an Irish Chicagoan. I now realize that is exactly why. But he comes through the door and he's like, "Hey, Charlie, how you doing? How's everyone doing? Great, great." And he'll start talking, and it's great because he treats my younger cousins like newborn puppies who were never trained. They put me over on the couch with my dad, like, "Yeah, the Cubs are doing great this year. I think they should win the World Series. Hey, no more chips till dinner. You're gonna spoil your appetite. Yeah, I think they have a really good pitcher." They say, "Hey, Keegan, sit. Keegan, sit. Good boy." And I feel fortunate for everyone on the earth that they are close enough to drive to our house during Christmas instead of flying. Because for everyone in that airport, it would be both terrifying and loud. However, airplanes are already terrifying and loud. And this is all thanks to the airplane pilots, because they have control over what they say, and then they totally disregard it for the rest of the flight. So you could be on the plane halfway through the flight, and the pilot comes on and he's like,
"Thank you for taking our flight. Just a little heads up, we will have some turbulence. We may lose an engine on the way, but just buckle your seatbelts. Thank you."
And then nothing happens for a really long time, and you're just sitting there super nervous because you think you're gonna die, but you don't know. I was once on a plane to my grandma's house in Florida, and the pilot came on the intercom and he went,
"We will be descending into Fort Myers Airport in approximately 30 minutes. Thank you for flying with us, and make sure next time you fly Southwest."
I looked up at where the sound came from, and I was pretty sure that the plane was possessed, but I decided to ignore the thought. But 3 minutes later, I was minding my own business, and the intercom just goes on and goes,
"Thank you."
And it was very strange. I love how when pilots go on the intercom, they almost always sound like they took a giant bite out of a Subway sandwich before making the announcement. So they come on and like,
"Oh, thank you, we're back on the phone. Turtles, just for help that is going to be a mercy phone. Thank you."
And it's great. I also love with airplanes, they completely disregard anyone's allergies to peanuts. You might have an allergy to peanuts and they'll be serving them on the plane and go, "Excuse me, if those go near me, I will die immediately." And they'll go, "Oh, don't worry, they're honey roasted." Yeah, they're still peanuts. But, you know, when you step on an airplane, you increase your chance of death that day by 64%. So why not just make it 75? If you don't want to fly a plane because they're terrifying, you can always take public transit or the train. However, I personally believe that trains were built to look like a crime was supposed to be committed on them. Because you walk on and it smells like chemicals, there's green tinted windows and leather seats, and always one guy in each car that's just sitting there, and you go, "Yeah, he's gonna rob a CVS when he gets off." And it doesn't help that trains never come at normal times. It's always like, "Now boarding the 421 to Aurora." And you're like, "Just make it 420 and have everyone with OCD happy. Just please." And then you always see someone on the train that you know. But you never acknowledge that you see them or say hi to them at all. You're just like, you get home and you're like, honey, I saw Jeff on the train today. She's like, oh, how was he? I don't know. But he hasn't lost any weight in 3 years, so he's got that going for him. I don't like to take the train or planes. What I like to do is I like driving. I don't like to drive. I like driving. I have my permit right now, so when I have to drive, it's with my parents. And that's not very fun. Because they both have their own way of making it seem like it's the worst thing on earth. Like with my dad, he's very like calm, but very cynical. Like I'll be driving and he'll be sitting there just like, if you want to get home, you're going to have to merge, but you know, we could just keep going straight. Doesn't bug me any. And then with my mom, she acts like every left turn will be her. So, we'll be going, we'll be driving, and we have to make a turn, and she'll be like, okay, Charlie, now turn. Turn, Charlie, slower, slower. Charlie, going too fast! You're going to crash! Okay, that was good, that was good. Driving in the car because I don't have to worry about crashing, but I like to play car games with my friends, and the best car game is Sweet and Sour, because you become a safety hazard to every other driver on the road while you're trying to wave at them and have them wave back. Now, some may say this isn't fun, but for me and my friend group it is, because we compete to who can get the most waves, and my friend Nate is very competitive, because we'll be driving and he'll look out the window, he'll lock in on a target, and he will go mad wild waving until they respond. And one time we were downtown Chicago and we were driving, and he saw someone, and they were smoking, and in his head, his middle school head, he went, my middle school teacher said that smoking isn't good and that you'll die from that. So he decided that when we were driving up, we were driving past, and he just yelled out, smoking's bad for you! And my dad, who was driving, calmly rolled up the window and said, we're done now. And I, myself, am done now. Thank you so much for letting me do this.